Hi, thank you so much for joining us on this incredible Resurrection Sunday. My name's Jared Neiman. I'm one of the pastors here at Abundant. And let me just say, happy Easter to you. I'm so blessed that you and your family would connect with us today from wherever you're watching in the world, whether you're a member of our church at Abundant Living here in El Paso, Austin, Lockhart, or wherever you're joining us from. Welcome to Abundant Living. We're so glad that you're joined with us today. If it's your first time, we'd like to welcome you. Thank you so much for connecting with us. Wow, I hope you know that we love you. Our church loves you. Most importantly, I hope you know that God loves you. We'd love to be able to connect with you. You'll see some information come up on the screen. Text us, reach out to us so that we can get connected with you. Let me just tell you a couple other things before we go into our incredible resurrection services. We have something for everyone. We have an incredible kids program, an amazing teen program, and a lot of things we offer for young adults. So check it out so that your kids can watch church at their level. Prime Essential and Prime Culture is our program that we offer for teens and young adults. It's really great. So check out their Instagram, their YouTube pages. Before we go further, I just want to tell you a couple other things. We're here for you. I hope you know that. I hope you know that we believe with all our hearts that we're blessed to be a blessing, and that extends to a lot of levels. Since this pandemic started and our doors were closed, we have been trying to keep church alive, though. And the heart of the church is the people. And so we've been out in our community on a lot of levels trying to help people, delivering food and prescriptions to the elderly and reaching out to single moms. We've been helping people with diapers and goods and services. We've been feeding thousands of people with an incredible partnership we have with El Pasoans Fighting Hunger at our Westside Church. Every day we've been giving over 1,000 boxes of food. Again, we believe in generosity. And so if you need help, you'll see an email come up on the screen right now. It's care@alfc.com. Reach out to us. We have counseling, prayer. All of our pastors are ready to talk to you and help you through dealing with these unprecedented situations. Our motto is this: if we can help you, we will. If for some reason we can't, we'll just be honest with you. But we believe that that God has blessed us so that we can help most people. Before we go into the service, let me just again say thank you so much for spending Easter Sunday with us. We have an incredible service planned for you, so please enjoy. God bless you.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Resurrection Sunday. We're going to celebrate the name of Jesus together. So come on, wherever you find yourself across the screen, why don't you stand to your feet, lean in. We're going to praise God together. You ready?
And I've searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures of faith are never enough. You came along and put me back together, and every desire is now satisfied here in love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. I know it's true. I'm not afraid to show you my weakness, my failures and flaws. Lord, you see me more, and you still call me friend. 'Cause the God of the mountain is the God of the valley, and there's not a place your mercy and grace won't find me again. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you. There's nothing, nothing.
Turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn praise into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who cares. You're the only one who cares. Oh, there's nothing
Welcome. Happy Easter. Thank you so much for joining us today. I just want to take a moment to share with you a couple of thoughts. If you've got your Bible, would you open it with me to Revelation chapter 1? Maybe you want to follow along on your phone. You can look at the Bible app. We pick up in this incredible moment. John is on the island of Patmos. We're going to begin reading in verse 12. It says, "When I turned to see who was speaking to me, I saw seven golden lampstands. And standing in the middle of the lampstands was someone like the Son of Man. It was Jesus. He was wearing a long robe with a gold sash across his chest. His head and his hair were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes like flames of fire. His feet were like polished bronze, refined in a furnace, and his voice thundered like mighty ocean waves. He held seven stars in his right hand, and a sharp two-edged sword came from his mouth, and his face was like the sun in all its brilliance. John says, "When I saw him, I fell at his feet as if I were dead. But Jesus laid his right hand on me, and he said, 'John, don't be afraid, for I am the first and I am the last. I am the living one. I died, but look, I am alive forever and ever, and I hold the keys of death, hell, and the grave.'" I hold the keys of death, hell, and the grave. My family, this is really what Easter is all about. It's all about Jesus' resurrection. We know the story. He went and he battled the devil. He battled death, hell, and the grave, and he overcame him. And he overcame him victoriously. And I just want to take a moment to speak with you. I love the picture that these verses paint. I see John there on the island, and all of a sudden he hears this voice, or he sees Jesus, and he's startled. We see his reaction. He becomes overcome with fear. And then we see our Savior comfort him. He places his hand on him and he says, "John, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid." Maybe you're afraid right now. Maybe you're joining us today and the situation of the world around you has bound you in fear. I want to remind you today that you have a Savior who says, "Don't be afraid." Don't be afraid. Why? Because Jesus says, "I am the first and I am the last. And I am the living one. I am alive forever and ever." And be reminded that Jesus says, "Don't be afraid, because I hold the keys to death, hell, and the grave." Let's look at verse 18 for a moment. It's important that you understand what this means. You see, Jesus didn't just go down to hell and beat up on the devil. Jesus went to hell and he overcame the devil, not temporarily, but permanently. You see, he removed the devil's authority from him. He stripped it from him. He took it from him. That's why Jesus says, "I now hold the keys. I now hold the keys to death, hell, and the grave," because he went down and he removed the devil's authority. When you study that phrase out, it says that it denotes the power to call men and women out of their current life and into a better life. You have been called to a better life. You have been called to a new life with Jesus. And listen, through the resurrection, I love this idea. I just want to paint this picture for you this morning. Through Jesus's resurrection, anyone can hear his call. Anyone. Anyone can hear his call, and they can choose to leave their old life and step into a new life. Now, I'm not just talking about breaking an old habit or picking up a new habit. I'm talking about a radical change, a change of your life, where you go from this old life and you step into a new life. And this new life is for anyone, anyone. Maybe religion has lied to you. Maybe people around you have misled you. Hear this today. This call from God is for anyone. This call is regardless of age. It's regardless of demographic. It's regardless of your past. It's regardless of your present. In fact, it's regardless of your future. This call is for anyone. It's regardless of your current circumstance, and it is regardless of the coronavirus. It is for anyone. This new life that God has for you is for anyone. Thank God this morning that he is no respecter of persons. He loves you and he is calling you. I want to ask you something today. Do you remember the moment when you first felt God call you? Do you remember it? You see, I think Easter is a great day to reflect on the moment that you first felt God reach down into your world and start calling you. I think it's important that on Easter that we reflect on this moment, that we reflect on how God has saved us and how He continues to save us, that we reflect on how much He loves us and how He continues to love us. Isn't it incredible when you stop and you think about it, how God saves you and He loves you even when you don't deserve it? Even when you can't feel it or you're not aware of it, God is saving you and He is loving you and He is calling you. Amen? God is calling you. And what does He call you to? He calls you to a new life. He calls you to the God kind of life. John 10:10 says, I have come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. This call is for anyone. This call is to the God kind of life. This call is to a better life. This call is to a call of peace, to a call of health, to a call of provision, to a call of love, to a call of grace, to a call of mercy, to a call of favor, to a call of acceptance. This call is for everyone. And it's not just for a temporary moment, it's for eternity. This call is to a better life and it is for you. It is for you. This call is for right now. Amen. I want to close with this last verse, John 3:16. For God so loved the world, you probably know it by memory, that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Whosoever. It doesn't say certain people, it says whosoever. Why? Because God calls anyone. He calls whosoever's to a better life. In closing, know this today. Hear me when I say this to you. God loves you. God loves you. He has delivered you from the power of death, hell, and the grave. That's what we're celebrating today. Our deliverance from that old life. Our deliverance from the power of the enemy. Our deliverance from death, hell, and the grave. And our calling to a new life. Our calling to the abundant life. Hey, thank you so much for sharing these few moments with me. Well, I love you. I'm praying for you. God bless you.
Your worth and word at the beginning, one with God at the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in You are Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is, nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. So Jesus, You brought Him down. My sin was great, Your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. Yes, You are.
Let's sing this together.
Death, can I hold you? The veil torn before you. You silence the birds of sin and grief. The heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory. For you are
Easter, happy Resurrection Sunday. Thank you so much for joining us. I just want to take a moment and read some scripture to you. If you have your Bible, you can go to it, but it's 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 16 and 17. It says here, "For if the dead do not rise, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins." Listen to those words. For if the dead do not rise, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, your faith is futile. You know, we're here on Resurrection Sunday, and we're celebrating what Jesus did on the cross. But I just want you to think about this. The cross would have been for nothing if we didn't have resurrection. We, as God's children, needed Jesus to die, but also to rise again. Because during the period, the 3 days from when he died to when he rose again, he conquered death, hell, and the grave. And because of what he did on the cross, where he was made sin so that we could be forgiven, where he was made a curse so that we could be blessed, where he was made sick so that we could be healed, because of what he did on the cross, when he rose again, all of what he did came into a covenant for you and I. And I think we should just take a moment and thank God for what Jesus did on the cross. Why don't you just take a couple seconds and say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for what you did for me. Thank you, Jesus, that I am your child. Thank you, Jesus, that I am forgiven. Thank you, Jesus, that you have accepted me. Isn't that an amazing concept? That God accepts you right where you are for who you are. Isn't that incredible? That in spite of where you've been or what you've done, in spite of maybe the foolishness of your past, the God of the universe, the Almighty, loves you. He cherishes you. He values you. In fact, He loves you so much, He sent His Son Jesus to die for you, but also to be raised again into life, because God wants you to have life. He wants you to have the abundant life. He wants you to have eternal life. And that's why we gather today. That's what we're worshiping. That's what we are celebrating. We are celebrating the resurrection of our divine Savior, Jesus Christ. And when He rose victorious. He rose with life in His hand. He rose with grace and with mercy. He rose with peace and with hope. He rose with faith in His hands, but not just in His hands, He came to give it to all of us. Any person, the Bible says, that would believe in Him would be accepted into His family. Praise the Lord. You know, I can't think of anything better than we could do at this moment, as we're in between incredible worship songs, than take a moment and honor God by receiving communion together. Listen, I just want to give you a second to go get some bread, get some juice. We don't have to be religious about this. I've got one of our communion cups from the church building. But listen, wherever you are, just go get something. Go get a piece of bread, a cracker of any type of juice. Even if you just have water, it's fine. Listen, this isn't about what you're eating and drinking. This is about honoring our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ, for what He did on the cross. I know I mentioned this during the intro, but maybe you joined us a couple minutes late. But as you get your communion ready, I just want to remind you that we're here for you. You're gonna see an email come up on the screen. It's care@alfc.com. We're here for you. I know there's been all sorts of pressure. Anxiety has risen up in people's hearts and minds. The unknown has caused us to get nervous or maybe fearful. I want you to know we're here for you. If you need to talk to someone, reach out to us. All of our pastors are available for counseling, for prayer calls. Reach out to us. If you need something, let us know and we'll try to help you. Also, we're continuing to give food out, so please stay connected with us. Hopefully you have your bread and your cup ready. Let's take the bread in our hand, and we're just gonna pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you right now, Lord, with this bread, the bread that represents the broken body of Jesus Christ. And Father, we thank you that His body was broken so that we could be healed. The Bible says that He bore our sicknesses and carried our diseases, and by His stripes, we are healed. Father, I just declare right now that healing is in our land. Father, I believe that COVID-19 is being defeated in the name of Jesus. But Lord, I know there's people out there that are dealing with other things. And I just declare at the sound of the name of Jesus that cancer is defeated, lupus is defeated, the flu is defeated, and heart disease is defeated, diabetes is defeated. God, we declare that we are healed in the name of Jesus. Father, I thank you that our Lord and Savior was made poor that so we could be well supplied. We put our trust in you right now, Lord, as our source and our supply. And we declare Philippians 4 over our lives. And we believe that all of our needs are met according to your riches in glory through your supply in Jesus' name. And Father, we eat this bread now in honor, in reverence, and in worship of what Jesus Christ did for us on the cross. And now, Lord, we take the cup of blessing, the cup that represents the shed blood of our Savior on the cross at Calvary. And Lord, With all our hearts, we honor you. We worship you. We thank you that his blood was shed so that ours will not be. Father, we thank you right now that you loved us so much that you gave your only begotten Son so that if we would choose to believe in him, we would have everlasting, eternal life. Father, we thank you that you have forgiven all of our sins. We thank you that you have accepted us. We thank you that because of Jesus Christ, we have a hope and a future, knowing that you are on our side, that you make a way for us, that you lead us and guide us into the abundant life that Jesus wanted us to have. And Father, with all our hearts, we take this cup and we drink it now in honor, in celebration, and in worship of the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Oh, praise the Lord. Once again, thank you so much for joining us in our Resurrection Sunday services. I hope you have a wonderful Easter. Enjoy the rest of the service. God bless you.
Death could not hold you. The veil torn before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring. The praise of your glory. For you are raised to life again. You have no rival, you have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name.
We as a church family began to declare and to continue to believe that God is the God of miracles, signs, and wonders. Little did we know that we'd be in the position that we're in now, here in the spring, in a global pandemic where miracles are needed more than ever. And I believe that God has positioned us through our heart, through the heart of who He is and the heart of what He has inspired for many years in our church, and to believe that we are blessed to be a blessing. To believe in generosity on extreme levels. He has positioned us to be a miracle for people and for our community through our initiatives in feeding and clothing people. God is moving through our church. The doors may be closed, but the church is open. It is alive. It is moving in people's homes and across our community. Thank you, church, for taking serious that we are the hands and feet of Jesus. Thank you, church, for loving people, for having compassion for people, for reaching out to people. Thank you, church family, for going beyond the four walls of our church and being the church, being the miracle, recognizing that we can bring wonders and hope, restore faith and encouragement in people's lives. Thank you, church, for not just resting during this time, but for being alive and being a blessing to our city and our community. God bless you. We love you.
I'm so thankful that in this very difficult time in our nation, hey, in the world, that our church is able to continue doing all of the things that you have just seen. And you know, as I was watching that video, I was just struck with the idea that this isn't something new for us. These are things that we have done for decades as a church family. Praying with people, counseling with people, being there for people, feeding people, helping people, reaching out to people, all the things that you saw. And I want to say thank you, first of all, to all of our volunteers, the amazing men and women of our church that have made these things happen. Could I hear a good amen, right? None of this happens. You can have the idea, but if you don't have people that carry out the idea doesn't go anywhere. And so I just thank God for our wonderful serving family at our church, and then also for our giving family, because it's our giving family that has made much of this possible. It's your tithes, your offerings, your willingness to give, your willingness to say that, you know, so we're not meeting in our building, but we're still a church family. And our giving is vital. It's critical. It's critical for us. It's critical for our community. It's critical for the outgoing and the continual expansion of the kingdom of God. So I want to ask you again today to honor the Lord with the giving of your tithe and your offering. And, you know, probably doesn't need to be said, but I'm going to say it anyway. You know, is there any other weekend where we should be honoring the Lord with the giving of our tithes and offerings more than Easter weekend? I don't think so. And the reason why I say that is because in Luke chapter 6, verse 38, remember, Jesus said, give because you believe God has given to you. And truly, of all the weekends where we can say, wow, I believe God has given to me, it would be this weekend, huh? So I pray now that all of you that are a part of our giving family, that you'll continue to stand with us and that you'll take this opportunity this weekend where our hearts are so full of gratitude for salvation and all the things that Shannon and Jared have already shared with you today, that our hearts will take that next step and that we'll honor the Lord with the giving of our tithe and our offering. You know, in Luke 6, verse 38, listen, Jesus said, give because you believe God has given to you. Get ready, and it shall be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over shall men give into your pocket. For the way you measure it out is the way it'll be measured back to you. My family, I want to remind you today that this virus has not stopped God's promises. Let me say that to you again. COVID-19 has not stopped God's promises. And so we're going to sow and we're going to give and we're going to believe God for the return on our giving. Are you ready? Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you today for this opportunity on this great Resurrection Day weekend to honor you and to say thank you through our giving for what you have given to us. And we believe today that as we give our tithe and our offering, we give it so there may be resources in the house of God, so there may be provision for the vision, and we thank you for it. And we believe today that as we give, say it with me, it shall be given to us good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over in Jesus' name, amen. Thank you so much. Up beside me on the screen, you can see all the different ways to give. And, you know, if we were in our building now, I'd be talking to you about envelopes and all that stuff. But, you know, we don't do that now. But we will. We're coming back. All right. We're going to be back together. And I believe sooner rather than later. And so just you can give through text to give. You can give online. All the information is there. If you want to mail your tithe and offering in, the address is there on the screen. You know, a few people are still like to drop it off at the office. There's somebody there, you know, Monday through Friday, regular business hours, if you'd like to drop it off. So, you know, we're there for you. Thank you so much for standing with us. And again, we believe with you for God's return on your giving. You know what giving does? Giving says, I believe I have a future. Right? My giving doesn't go into my past. My giving doesn't stay in my present. My giving goes into my future and becomes my harvest. And so through our giving, we are saying, I believe I have a future, and I believe we have a future still. Amen? Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. The Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen. 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 And keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to me. Lord, turn his face toward you and give you peace. Generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and 1,000 generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and 1,000 generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you, he is with you, in the morning, in the evening, in your coming and your going. For you, he is
I'm going to pick up now where Jared and Shannon have already talked to you today and laid out some of the great Bible truths surrounding Easter, surrounding Resurrection Day. And I am so grateful and so thankful that I'm able to come to you this way and share these great truths with you today. And I believe this may be the most important Easter message that I've ever delivered in my 43 years of pastoring and being in the ministry. I believe it because we are living in such a unique time. Our generation, all of us alive together today, we will remember 2020. It's not something that's going to go away from us right away. And it's something that we're all in this together, and we're all in this challenge together. And so I really believe that God has placed something on my heart to speak to you. And I believe it almost has a prophetic side to it, that I'm actually going to be talking to you about your present and your future and what I believe God wants us to start thinking, believing, and speaking, starting today, regarding our lives in the light of His resurrection. So I believe that we are at war. I believe that we are at war, and maybe that's not a popular thing to say on Easter Sunday, but I believe we are. I believe we're at war. I believe we're at war, and I wrote some things down, that we are fighting for our health. We are fighting for our families. You know, I read a statistic the other day, and they said that, you know, marital problems are increasing during this time, that domestic violence has gone up, you know, that drug abuse has gone up, alcohol abuse has gone up. My family, we're in a fight, right? So we're fighting for our families. I believe that many of us, that in fact, we are fighting for our way of life, for our way of life. If we're not careful, you know, this can alter the way we live. We are fighting for our jobs, many of us, for our mental health and our society, for our present and our future. Now, think about that for a moment. Now, maybe all of those don't touch your life. I hope they don't all touch your life, but I bet some of them touch your life in some degree. So we're here. And I believe, as we've been saying to you since all of this began a month ago, that we must choose faith over fear. We must choose it. We must fight for it, because the spirit of fear is trying so hard to take over our believing, our speaking, our living, our dreaming, even our planning for the future. The spirit of fear. And if we are not careful, how we walk, how we think, how we believe, how we speak, our lives can be permanently altered in a way that God never intended. Our lives can be permanently altered, stolen, even destroyed. And I want to remind you today in John 10:10, Satan said, "The thief comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy." And I think that all of us today, we may not agree on everything, but I would think all of us would agree today that this virus could be defined by the fruit of this virus is stealing, killing, and destroying. So we are in a fight. And we have got to make sure that our thinking, our believing, our living, our acting, our speaking, that we are in harmony with the kingdom of God and the principles that God has given us. So when we began this year, just a few months ago, seems longer than that now, doesn't it? But when we began this year, just a few months ago, those of you that are part of our church family, what did we tell you we felt was the thing that God wanted us to focus on in 2020? Miracles, signs, and wonders. So I want to ask you a question today. All right, do you still believe in miracles, signs, and wonders? If you do, could you say amen? You know, I couldn't hear you. Would you do it again, please? There you go. Right, so we still believe in miracles, signs, and wonders. And this weekend, right, in this weekend, More than any other weekend in the Christian calendar, we believe in miracles, signs, and wonders because the resurrection is a miracle, a sign, and a wonder. Amen? You can call it whatever you want, but it is all of that and more, right? It is a miracle, a sign, and a wonder. And so here we are gathered together. And again, I want to say to you, I'm so grateful that we have technology that we can still have church together. Imagine 20 years ago, I would have lost all contact with you. I mean, maybe a letter, right, would have been it, or a phone call. But now we can have church. I'm so grateful. But it doesn't compare to when we get back together again, right? And man, am I looking forward to that. So today we are celebrating this great miracle, this great sign, this great wonder of resurrection. Now, Jesus' resurrection, listen to me now, released into our world, into our lives, the new covenant. A better covenant with better promises, Hebrews 8 says. So release this new covenant into our lives. It also made it possible for you and I to live in the kingdom of God. Colossians 1, 13 and 14 says that the Son that God loves so much came and delivered us from the kingdom of darkness and translated us into the kingdom of God. And so he came and he brought, through the resurrection, he gave us this new covenant, and this new covenant now has brought the kingdom of God to us and us to the kingdom of God. So now we are living in that kingdom. In that kingdom belongs to us. So listen to me. When God established all of this, think with me now. When God established the kingdom, when God established the covenant, when he made it possible for you and I to become children of God, God knew something. All right? Well, Pastor, he knows everything. I know. But he knew, listen, this really helped me. He knew that life can be complicated. He knew that inside of life, there can be good times, bad times, happy times, sad times. He knew there can be great times. He knew there can be difficult times. Hey, let me tell you something. He even knew that there could be frightening times in this thing called life. And in the light of everything he knew, get ready, he still said, I've come to give you life and life more abundantly. He looked at all of that, knowing that all of that could happen, that all of that would happen, and still said, I'm still going to give you life and life more abundantly. Even though the thief comes to steal, kill, and to destroy, I'm going to come to give you life in overflow. And that overflow life belongs to each of us. All right? He still said John 10:10. And it belongs to each and every one of us. Now, I'm going to ask you, it's going to sound like a silly question, but I'm doing it on purpose, and I believe sometimes we need to get back down to some real basics. So, I want to ask you now, all right, are you ready? Is COVID-19 greater than the resurrection? No, of course not. What a ridiculous. I even put in my notes, capital N, capital O, explanation point, explanation point, explanation point. Of course it's not. Of course it's not. But I want to talk to you right now in the last few moments I have about taking resurrection from a truth that we believe in to a truth that we live in. That we live in the reality of it. All right? In Philippians chapter 3, verse 10, Paul said, I pray that I may know him and that I may know the power of his resurrection. Now, that belongs to you and me too. That he wants us, number one, to know him. So I want to ask you real quick, are you spending time with the Lord? I bet you are, right? Are you leaning in more, right? Remember James said, as we draw close to him, he draws close to us. You know, I pray that we're going to take this time that has been forced upon us, and let's make it count in our area of getting closer to the Lord, right? I believe it'll be a shame if we have all this time at home, all this time we're stuck in our houses, and we come out of this and we're not closer to the Lord than we were when we went into it. Amen. All right? So he said that I may know him and the power of his resurrection. So he went there from not just the theory of resurrection, so to speak, but the living reality of resurrection, that I may know the power of his resurrection. Now, the word power there means the factuality of his essential power, right? So he said, I want to know the resurrection in fact, not in theory or an idea, but in fact. So I want to know, Paul said, we can know the reality of resurrection factually. Means something to me. Doesn't just mean something to Jesus. Doesn't just mean something to me as far as salvation. It means something to me in my daily living. Now, write this down. The word resurrection in the Bible has two basic definitions. Number one, it means stand up. And number two, it means recovery. Stand up and recovery. Paul said, I want to know the factual reality of his power, the power of his stand-up and his recovery. Do you know that God wants you to experience that? Do you know that he wants you to have that kind of experience in your life and your walk with him to where you experience factually, to where you can say, I can point to this incident, I can point to this circumstance, I can point to this thing right here where I saw the reality of his stand-up and his recovery in my life. What an incredible thing, right? Stand up and recovery. Would you right now wrap your believing, your thinking, your expectation around that truth and bring that into your life right now and wrap your faith around that as your future, right? Stand up and recovery. Now, in John chapter 11, verse 25, Jesus makes the great statement that we all know. At the tomb of Lazarus, he said, I am the resurrection and the life. Now, again, that word, listen to him, he said, I am. I want to point that out to you. Jesus did not say, I was. He didn't say, I will be sometime in the future. He said, I am, present tense. So what does that mean to me and you? Right here, right now, Easter Sunday, 2020, Jesus, this is going to be bad grammar, but get ready. Jesus am the resurrection and the life. He am it, all right? He is it. He is that right here, right now, for me, for you, for my family, for your family, for our city, for other people's city, for our country. He is the stand-up, the stand-up, the stand-up, and the recovery. But then he also said he is the life. Now, that word life means that he is the life that satisfies, get ready, because he dwells in your life. Hey, when trouble comes to the front door, God doesn't go out the back door. The psalmist said that he is a very present help in time of trouble. So he is our stand-up, he is our recovery, and he is our life that satisfies. All right? Now, in the light of that, I'm going to ask you this. Do you still believe in this miracle? Do you still believe that Jesus is the stand-up, the recovery, and the life that satisfies? Do you believe in the power of resurrection? Can your life go through a resurrection? Can your family go through a resurrection? I say amen. I say yes, it can. I say why not believe this instead of believing something else? Amen? Let's believe for stand-up and recovery. Now, I've got just a few moments, but I want to drop another great truth on your heart today. In the book of Acts, the third chapter, this is one of the things that God brought into our world because of the resurrection of Jesus, and it's one of the great promises of living in the new covenant. All right, Acts chapter 3, Peter is speaking on the day of Pentecost, and in verse 19, he says, "Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out." Watch, when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. The times of refreshing. Hey, right now today, let's believe for a refreshing to come from us from the presence of the Lord. That word refreshing literally means the blessings of Jesus and his kingdom come into your life. The blessings of Jesus. Say amen to that. Right there, say amen to that. Say, you know what the word amen? Amen doesn't mean the end. Amen believes, let what he said be true to me. So say amen to a times, multiples of the blessings of Jesus and his kingdom coming into your life, and they come from the presence of the Lord. Now, that's good, but that's not the main thing I wanted to share with you, right? Then he says, and he shall send Jesus Christ, which before was preached unto you, whom the heaven must receive until the times of restitution of all things. So what he says here is that in between the first coming of Jesus and the second coming of Jesus, there's going to be times of refreshing being given to us, blessings of Christ and the kingdom, and times of restitution. Now, that word restitution means restoration. Restoration. So listen, on this resurrection day, where we celebrate Jesus being raised from the dead and bringing us forgiveness for our sins and bringing us into the kingdom of God, and in that kingdom, there is restoration. There is stand up and there is recovery. Do you see how all those words fit together? Right? Stand up, recovery, restoration. They're all speaking to the same promise, to the same desire that God has for your life, my life, our church, your business, your family, my family, our community, our nation. Stand up, recovery, and restoration. And a life that satisfies because he is in that life. Restoration. One text says, everything in between the first coming and the second coming, everything that was lost shall be restored. Everything that was lost that can be restored shall be restored, another translation says. So he wants to restore everything that was lost. My family, this is not the time to start waving the white flag and surrender and give up on dreams, hopes, visions, and the abundant life that Jesus came to give you, right? You may be saying to me, Pastor, I'll never be happy again. Yes, you can be. Charles, I feel like I've lost my faith. But hey, you can get it back. He is the God of restoration. Let's not accept this sense of loss, this sense of regret. Let's not accept that as our future. Let's believe, starting right now, today, let's start believing. Let's lift our eyes up. Let's look out into the harvest fields, right, of the abundant life that Jesus has given us. And let's believe, starting right now, this Resurrection Sunday, let's start believing for stand up, recovery. Let's start believing for restoration. Let's start believing that God is going to restore everything that the locust has come to steal from us. Let's start believing. Let's focus our thinking. Let's focus our speaking. Let's focus our believing. Let's focus all of that on and for restoration. Let's stand up and recovery. Let's do it. Hey, almost done. But in the rest of the chapter of John 11, where Jesus said, I'm the resurrection and the life, guess what else he said? It said, when he went to the tomb of Lazarus, he groaned within himself. The word groan means he roared. You know what? Some of you need to get your roar back. This Resurrection Sunday, you need to stand up. You need to let Jesus stand up on the inside of you and get your roar back. You need to get your roar back. You need to quit walking around like a little scared kitten, and you need to walk around like the lion of the tribe of Judah. You need to get your roar back. Can I hear a good amen? You need to get your roar back. You need to quit being afraid. You need to quit being all torn up. You need to get your roar back. There is a kingdom for you. There is a God who was raised from the dead, who is still on your side. When COVID came to the front door, he didn't go out the back door. God's not running with his tail between his legs. And we are the children of God. Amen? He is our stand-up. Say it with me. He is my stand-up. He is my recovery. He is my restorer of all things. Right here, right now, I'm back in the game. Amen? Amen? Amen. Let me pray with you right now. Wherever you are, if you can, I'm going to ask you, just slip your hands up towards heaven. I want to pray for you right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, I'm remembering right now as we pray in Exodus 22, you said when a person has been stolen from and they come before the judge, that they are to say, that is mine. And Lord, today I say, that is mine. Say it right now. What have you lost? Have you lost your faith? Have you lost your peace? Have you lost your joy? Huh? Have you lost your job? Say, that is mine. Say, that is mine. Take back what you know God has for you. Say it. That is mine. That is mine. Huh? That is mine. That is mine. Peace is mine. Joy is mine. Health is mine. Cure is mine. Prosperity is mine. Strength is mine. That is mine. That is mine. That is mine. Come on, get your roar back. That is mine. That is mine. Take back. Claim what God has given to you. And Lord, I believe today that right here, right now, we set our faith, we set our focus, we set our hope, we set our future on restoration, stand up, and recovery. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You know, it's been such a joy being with you today. And before we go off the air today, I want to give you the opportunity to become a child of God today. Now, how do we become a child of God? Right? How do we become a child of God? Well, first of all, it's important to know that the ability to become a child of God was presented to us because of God's great love for each of us. You know, we say it all the time, right? God loves us so much. And I think that to some degree, maybe we've almost become a little callous to it, and it kind of bounces off of us, you know? Yeah, whatever. But, you know, let's never become that way. And if we have, let's reject it. And let's understand today that God loves you right where you are. Loves you. Now, how do you become a child of God? You become a child of God because you jump through all these hoops, because you get your life together, because you get your act, you know, all cleaned up and you maintain sinless life. No, that's impossible. You become a child of God by accepting Jesus as your Lord and your Savior. It's a very powerful moment in your life. What do I mean by that? What makes it so powerful, Charles? Because to do that, you would have to admit that you need a Savior. To admit you need a Savior, you have to admit that you're a sinner, that you have sinned. We all have, all of us. The Bible says all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And yet God extended His great love towards us and provided His Son as the Lamb of God to take away the sins of the world. And by believing in Him, we can all become the children of God. The Bible said, whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord, are you whosoever? I am, right? That whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. In a moment, I'm going to ask you, let me pray with you today. If you've never accepted Jesus into your life and confessed Him as your Lord and your Savior, this is your moment. Today is your day to become a child of God. Or maybe you'd say, Charles, at one time I was much closer to the Lord than I am now. But I got offended, or I got distracted, or I got hanging around with the wrong guys, or whatever. What's important is you're watching right now and you're hearing God's call on your life, like Shannon talked about earlier. You're hearing God's call on your life. And now open that door and get your life back on track with Him. Are you ready to pray? You want to make Jesus Lord? You want to get your life back on track? Let's pray. Say after me, Lord Jesus, I believe in You. And I receive You now as my Lord and my Savior. Come into my life. I need You. I put You on the throne of my heart. I repent of my sins. Thank You for forgiving me. From now on, Jesus, be Lord of my life. Amen. If you prayed that prayer today, would you please contact us through the number that's on the screen right now and let us know that you prayed with me today, because we want to help you. We want to get some material to you. We want to answer any questions you have. We want to help you in your new relationship with God. Well, man, I'm sorry to say that we're out of time. It's been so great being with you today. I hope you enjoy your Resurrection Day, your Easter Sunday. I hope you're around family and friends, and there's some people close to you. I know we can't have huge groups, and that's kind of hard of us in our community, hard on us, right? Because we like more the merrier. But I hope you're around some people. And if you're not, I hope you'll just focus and allow God to draw close to you, and you'll sense His presence in your life today. Love you. Let's be strong together. Let's believe now for stand up, recovery, and restoration. In Jesus' name, amen.
Wow, what an incredible time of encouragement. Hey, thank you so much for joining us today. And listen, if you prayed that prayer of salvation, welcome to our family. I just want to encourage you again. If you prayed that today for the first time, there's a number on the screen. Would you text that number? We want to connect with you. We want to help you get to know God better and just welcome you into our church family. That's really what we are. We are a family. Just a few more things. I hope you've downloaded our church app. If you haven't, get your phone out right now. Search for ALFC. The app is free and it's full of all kinds of incredible resources, including stuff for your kids. Do you know that we have a kids service online today? I hope that you'll sit down with your children and you'll check out Kingdom Kids on the app. The service is full of fun and full of great truth. And listen, let me just remind you one more time. We are in this together. We love you. We're praying for you. And if you need us, we want to be there for you. If you need prayer, if you need something, then reach out to us. Just email us at care@alfc.com. Again, thank you for being here today. God bless you and happy Easter.
Morning, guys. Hope you're having a great day. So I was nominated last night by Pastor Jared to demonstrate an act of love, and I'm gonna do that right now. I've got this extra mask. I'm gonna give it to this police officer right there. So let's see how this goes. All right. Well, that went well. He was very appreciative. He did not have a mask. El Paso police officer out there keeping us safe, and he did not have a mask.
find yourself across the screen today. Come on, can we put our hands together? We say, so I let go and I let love show me life like it's supposed to be. And away.
All right, so we're dropping off these Easter baskets for Ian and Liliana. We hope they love them. We love you guys. Who are we surprising today, DJ Justin?
Some girls.
Girls?
Morning, guys. Hope you're having a great day. So I was nominated last night by Pastor Jared to demonstrate an act of love. And I'm gonna do that right now. Got this extra mask. Let's give it to this police officer. Right there. So, let's see how this goes. All right, well that went well. He was very appreciative. He did not have a mask. I'll pass a police officer out there, keeping us safe, and he did not have a mask.
Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Hallelujah!